Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and in today's presentation, we're going to take a look at building conditional statements inside of our Ansible playbooks. We're going to take a look at what could be quite a realistic scenario for you to come across. We want to deploy the Apache web server maybe to 10 or 20 CentOS systems. Now we know probably on many of those systems, we're going to have firewall D running. It runs by default on CentOS 8. So we're going to go through and push out our firewall D rule to make sure that we can communicate through to our server on port 80 or port 443. However, the problem that we're going to get, if the firewall isn't running, then we can get problems trying to open up our firewall port. Of course. But if we go through and perhaps build into this a statement where we then go through and run firewall D, we don't potentially know what other services we might be blocking because we're only going to be opening port 80. So we can assume that port 80 will be open and probably port 22. That's going to be there by default. But any of our other services, perhaps like MariaDB or NFS, they're not going to be opened. So in deploying the web server, we're going to find that we break the MariaDB and we break NFS. So if we go through and start looking at what services are running, and based on that, apply our firewall D rules, we're then going to be able to choose to only apply the firewall D rules where firewall D is running. Do you want to take a look at this? I know I do. So here we are at the command line. We can see that this is a CentOS 8 host. And if you remember, if you've been watching some of these videos, the new Red Hat RHCE for version 8 is based around Ansible. So you're going to be able to use this to build up your skills for the RHCE. But anyway, let's take a look at our configuration before we get into this. Obviously, I'm in my home directory at the moment. We can see that from the tilde prompt, but also just going through printing our working directory. If I want to look at the configuration that's in use, I've actually created myself a file. If I look at it, ls.ansible.cfg, and we can then go through and see that that file is there. If I use cat and escape and dot, that brings up the last argument. We can obviously see what I've got configured. But there's a much easier way to see this. From any directory, we can go through and use the Ansible command. An ansible-config, if we go through taking a look at view, then we're going to open up the current configuration no matter where it exists. So we're able to see how we've configured it, and we don't even need to know the name of the configuration file or its location. This is just the effective file that's in use. But of course, our typing might not be perfect, and we might have got a key name incorrect or a slight typo somewhere. So what we can also do is we up arrow key and go through and look at dump. With the dump command, we're going to print out absolutely everything. But if we look at minus minus only changed, then we're going to see the changes that we've made from the default. So we can see then that we've got those same three settings that have picked up. So we know we've got then the configuration correct. Now in that configuration, we've put the path through to our inventory file. We've gone through and say the remote user, so the user that we're using to connect to, and the default connection method will be SSH. We've turned off host key checking, so if we don't already have the public key of the remote host, we then don't have to worry about accepting it. We'll automatically accept that public key. So this is then just set up and ready for us to go. I've also gone through and distributed the public key of the Tux user to the remote host, and on each of those systems, we've got passwordless access. So if I do a sudo minus L, we can see we've got passwordless access to sudo. And that's on both of my systems. We can look at the inventory file. If I go through and cat out the inventory file, and we just said that it was called inventory, so that's going to be in relationship to the configuration file. So it's in my home directory, and it's on my system 172.16.120 and 129 and 130. But again, we can go through and use the Ansible command. If we then go through and all minus minus list hosts, we get an idea of which hosts are included in my inventory. So we see we've got two hosts, and we can see then the range that I've put in is now expanded into each one of these individual hosts. And of course, probably our final test is just to make sure everything is up and running. Let's go through to all hosts. We'll use the Python ping module just to make sure that Python is responding, and we're then getting a response from all of these. Now, when we're working with Ansible, we really want to go through and create playbooks, and it's good to organize them within directories. So why don't we begin by going through and creating self a directory structure so we can look at then how we can start deploying the Apache web server to both of our systems. Now, as I say, pretty much we're going to need to create ourselves a directory to organize this. So let's go through and use mkdir minus p to create then the top level directory Ansible. And below that, we can then have a subdirectory called Apache. Keep things nice and tidy. CD and escape and dot is really good to get used to using. The escape and dot brings up your previous argument. We can then dive into our apache.yaml. So yeah, we're working with playbooks. Playbooks are YAML files. As we then go through, we can hit the insert key and start typing our YAML code. Now, normally YAML documents will start with three dashes. It has to be three dashes if we are going to use them, but they are optional. So we can put in our YAML header. Optionally, again, there's a YAML footer, and that's three dots. Again, these are optional. We don't have to put them in, but if we are going to put them in, then it has to be three dots. We can't put four dots or two dots. Then if we move back up, we can start creating the structure of our document by creating a play. We have a list of plays. So a list is designated by the dash. We give the play a name. Again, that's optional, but it really does help us understand what's going in. So we can say install and prepare Apache. Then we can go through and start setting other properties so we line up with the N of name. So we want to make sure then that the child and parent relationship is set up adequately. Here, we're all just siblings at the same level as the play. So we want it to run on all hosts. Again, still working within our play, we can put our become, so whether or not we need to elevate our privileges, and we do to install. And then we set up a list of tasks. So all of this are then part of our play. But the tasks themselves are not part of the play, they're part of the tasks dictionary. So we indent. So indentation is really important to set up then the child relationship. So these tasks are all part of the tasks dictionary. We can go through then and put up our name. So again, a list of tasks. Now I could use the yum module, but I choose not to. I'd rather use the package module because then that's going to work with either yum or apt or pkg or whatever your packaging system is. Once we put in the package and colon, we move then into properties of the package module. So again, we're looking at indenting beyond then our standard indent that we used before. So we can see the relationships all set up. The name's going to be httpd. We're just using CentOS systems. And the state we can put then to be latest. So this is going to make sure that it is installed and it's at the latest version. Now, I could continue and put the rest of the elements that we want, but it's sometimes good to take the approach in a very modular frame so we can then go through and test this is working rather than making a whole load of mistakes and having to fix them all in one go. So I'm going to choose to stop at this stage and test that the installation of the Apache web server is going just the way that I would like. So we can go through then and save our changes. Make sure then that we're writing this. And then at that stage, we can go through and use the Ansible playbook command. We use that to execute these glorious playbooks. Now we could just execute it straight away, but you might also choose to do a syntax check to make sure that everything looks okay. So we can add the minus minus syntax check-in. If you add it to the end of the line, it's very easy to up arrow key and delete the syntax check without having really to edit the line in too much. So as we go through, we can see the default task running, gathering facts, a little bit of information about what's up and running on that system. And we'll come back to that. But then importantly, we've seen then that we've installed Apache on both systems. Now, remember, that's only part of what we want. But again, also, we can demonstrate at this point the idempotency of playbooks. We can go back and replay that, but because we already meet the required state, there's nothing to be done. So although we could make our own scripts to do this, it's the Python modules that have been created that manage all of this complex logic to check that we don't have to go in and install it a second time. So we're seeing now everything is up and running the way that we want. So we can look at what else that we should do. So of course, we've installed Apache, but we haven't done anything about managing the service. So if we go back in and reopen this, and again, when we go in, we can see a little bit more about this indentation, but also the highlighting that I've got up and running. Now, of course, you can customize your own editor. I'm using Vim. And if we go through and take a look at my home directory and then the .vimrc, we can see then what I've got configured. So, okay, syntax highlighting is turned on. We want the background to be configured for dark, so our syntax highlighting. And then the auto CMD and file type for YAML, looking for YAML files, and then going through and setting locally, so overwriting the defaults where we're going to have auto indent, expand tabs. The CUC is then looking at that vertical bar, so lining up on my columns. The CUL is the line for underlying, and I've got my tab stop and my shift width set to 2. Now, as we then go back into the file, we're able to go through and see then the lining up nicely. We want to move back then to our list of tasks and add in a new task where we can go through and manage our service. So, of course, on our CentOS systems, the service is not started and enabled by default. So we can go through and use the service module. Again, my preference is the service module. There is a systemd module, but the service module is going to work both with my older services as well as with systemd. And I only really need the systemd module if there's things specific to systemd, such as masking and unmasking services that I need to handle. So my preference is the service module. Once we've got then our Python module noted, we can go through and specify the name of the service. Now, the name, again, is going to be HTTP, so the same name as our package. Now, we're not dealing with Ubuntu or Debian-based systems where the package name and service name would be Apache 2. So I don't need to consider variables. So we've taken out a level of complexity just being able to stick with our HTTPD package and service. And then we can go through and say we want the state to be started and enabled, we're going to set to true. And again, that's pretty much all that I need to type at the moment. Now, there's more that we're going to add in as we go through, but let's go through and save this, run our playbook. Now, we're going to see then that we meet the desired state for the installation, but our service now has changed. And again, we're going to do this pretty much every time to make sure that we've got this in our understanding. We can run this playbook as many times as we want. We're not going to be erroring out because, of course, we're going to be getting the desired state once we run it that second and third and fourth time. So this is really good to make sure that we're in the configuration and running it later to make sure we're still matching the desired configuration. But of course, our service is up and running now, but we don't have a web page. So we can go through then and edit this, add in a third task. We're getting pretty good at this, aren't we? So if we go through now and add in our task, as we go through, throwing in a name, And of course, we can set this maybe the name of the task to be our homepage or welcome page, whatever we feel is most appropriate. And for this, we can use the copy module. Now, using the copy module, we can go through and specify the destination, the page that we want to copy across to. So for this, we're going to put our var www and html. And of course, this is going to be the index.html page. Now, we could use source to copy across a page from a source location. But if it's only going to be a simple page with perhaps one line or one or two lines, we can put in content. And as I go through, we can actually make use of a variable and pick up on some information from our host name. So we can go through and put Ansible underscore and then FQDN, so looking at the fully qualified domain name. And this is picking up from that default task that we saw running, the gather facts. So we can pick up a fact of a machine and we can pick up its host name or fully qualified domain name. And we can then say, okay, it's server1.example.com web server. We can go through and finish there. And then, well, we're just about done with that copy. We don't really need to go through and put anything else. So we can go through again once we're ready, checking everything looks good and ready for us to run. We can go through and save our change. Now, of course, with just a couple of lines there, we haven't got a lot to check. So let's go through and save that. Now let's go through and apply this. And then again, we should see everything runs through, but we should be delivering then our web page. Now, our web page has been delivered. So we can then go through and use the curl tool. If I go to the localhost, we would be ignoring any of the firewall rules. Now we can see it probably hasn't got a full name set. So we've just got unallocated.barefruit.co.uk. So that's what we're getting on this system. But there's nothing stopping me checking the other system. Now on the other system, I know I don't have a firewall running. But on this system, I do. So if I go through and curl, I am going to be able to connect through to the IP address or the host name. I'm just going to use the IP address. Obviously, you use the IP address of your system. Now, on that remote system, the firewall is not running, so I do know the configuration of these. Obviously, I've set them up, so it works for me. But also, I've not really set the full host name on that, so it's just coming back with the same address. But they are the two different systems that we are using. So now that we've set that, let's go through and take a look at managing our firewall. Now for this, we can go back and use one of our ad hoc commands and check the firewall CMD and the state. So the state of our firewall D service, and we'll run this on both of our systems. So I know it's not running on the 130 system, but we're running on all. So as we then look, we can see, yes, that we're not getting any response. So it's not running. We're getting the error on the 130 system, my remote host. On this host, the firewall D is running and we're getting the state coming back from firewall D. We're up and running. Now, of course, this is my problem, as I said within the intro. If I go through and start putting firewall D rules in place, well, we're going to get errors as they won't run when the firewall D is not running. But if I try and force firewall D to run, we might have other services that are not included in the rules. So although I get Apache up and running, we're unable then to connect to other services. So we can then go through and handle this. Let's go back and just take a look at our Apache YAML. Now we know we're collecting facts at the moment, but we're not collecting all facts. So we can go through and start gathering some additional facts. So rather than collect absolutely everything when we don't really need it, we break it down and collect general information. But if we want information, let's say on our services, we can go through and collect this independently of that main gather tasks. So as I go through then and add in, we can use its own specific module. So service underscore facts. And there's nothing more than I need to do than run the module. And it will then go through and collect the facts based on my services. Then I can run conditional statements based on those services. So let's take a look now at setting up my firewall rules. We can go through and add in a new task. We can call it, let's say, firewall and Apache. We can go through then and use the firewall D module. Yes, firewall D has its own independent Python module. Firewall D, in any case, is Python managed, so it works well within our Ansible environment. Then as we go through, we want then to add the service HTTP, maybe also the HTTPS service, but we're just adding HTTP for the moment. We want it to take effect immediately, so we want it in the runtime configuration, but we also want it in the permanent configuration, so a restart of Firewall D will also have the configuration. And then we've got to say what sort of state do we want. So we can go through and say we want the service to be enabled, so added to. And here we're adding it to the default zone, but that's where we're working with. Of course, if I then ran this, we would get errors where Firewall D wasn't running. We don't want to enforce Firewall D running, but we can put in then our conditional statement. With a conditional statement, we specify when the task will run. And the key word for that, let me think, it's going to be when. So it's not really that difficult, is it? And it documents it. Now, having gathered then our service facts available to us as ansible_facts.services, and then as we go through and put, we can go in then and put the correct index. So firewalld.service. And then we can carry on our dot notation. Obviously, we've got dot service in the name here, so we have to use the older style notation with the square brackets. But we can put our two equals to look for it is equal to, and the state will actually be running. So with that then done, we can double check that it's all looking good, save our changes, and now we should conditionally run our rules. So as we go through, everything looks good. We're then checking our services, so gathering those facts. But we can see now, take a look at our firewall Apache. It's not running on the 130 system, but it's running on the 129. And of course, I can run this again as many times as I want. And as long as firewall D is not running on that remote system, then we don't apply the rule. Obviously, if we start up firewall D, then the rule can apply. But there you go, a simple way of ensuring we only apply a task when a service is running.